don't we live in this world where everything has to mean something to men? And for my purpose, naive or whatever you want to say it is, I actually want to just do something without thinking about the men around me.
And welcome to the Girl X Podcast, a weekly conversation with an inspiring woman. I'm Cooper Gillespie, and this week our inspiring woman is Rebecca Horn Black. You heard her at the top of the episode discussing her time as photo director for Playboy. She's also a creative producer. A film she produced opened Sundance the year it came out, and just a really fun conversation. Really quick, you might hear something that sounds like somebody making dinner in the middle of the episode. That is her husband, Chris, and he is doing that. Also, you might hear a few meows from their cat, Peaches. So, buckle up, guys. This is a super fun conversation. Here she is, Rebecca Horn Black.
All right. It's so good to see you.
Good to see you. How are ya?
I'm good, thanks. How are you guys holding up over there in Wisconsin?
You know, we're good. We feel like we're in this little bubble. I mean, I don't want to take anything for granted, but it's nice to be out of the hot spots, just being people that have lived in New York and LA, you know, I'm like, really feeling for those places right now. But we just feel like we're in this little Midwest, you know, healthy spot right now, comparatively.
Yeah, although there seems to be a lot of unrest in the Midwest too.
Yeah, so we're kind of like it's largely Milwaukee, and I mean it's just such a crazy. You don't know what to think. It's completely, you know, like nothing else. So
when we used to tour through Milwaukee, my impression was always that, well, because we used to play punk. And so it was always like the crusty punks lived in Milwaukee. I'm sure not all of Milwaukee is like that, but that's my impression, is just like dreaded punk rockers, you know, who all like 20 of them live in one house. It's probably changed since then.
Well, I feel like there's this punk rock thing where there's, if it's a smaller town, it's sort of less homogenized or something, you know, people that can congregate in larger groups in the city kind of like start to almost look kind of similar in their way, you know, in a way.
Yeah,
but smaller towns, grassroots and, you know, DIY everything.
Yeah, totally. Well, so I want to hear a little bit about your journey, because I think a lot of people would really be interested in what you do, but they would never have any idea how to do what you do or anything. Mm-hmm. So I think it'd just be interesting to hear like what, you know, your story kind of.
You know, I started out, I grew up in New Jersey by the beach, and it was totally shore culture. And everybody sort of wanted to live in California and be a surfer and, you know, have that life. And then it was, you know, the 90s. So you had the whole Nirvana and Soundgarden and all that stuff coming around. So there was this whole amalgamation of, you know, surf punk grunge thing happening. And it was a time when, you know, people emulated musicians in a different way, because they weren't created by an entire core of managers. I mean, they were, but just not to the degree I think they are today. So I feel like there was the birth of this whole kind of look that as teenagers, we all kind of wanted to have. And even photographically and cinematically, you know, there was this entire scene that developed that really pulled me into the world of art, you know? So In fact, my two best friends in high school ended up going to University of the Arts in Philadelphia, and I was a little bit younger than them. So that was sort of my first foray into the mesh of music and art. And I knew immediately that I wanted to be involved with photography, largely because I saw things in snapshots. You know, that's how I actually visualized the world. Like, it looked like as if something was stopping in a moment and I could see the picture. I didn't really know what that meant at that point in time or how to capture it. You know, it just didn't all kind of come together and make sense until I decided I wanted to study journalism because I love storytelling. And I ended up working with this creative director at a magazine interning. And we were putting together photo shoots. And it was really by default. Like, that was the internship that was available. And she needed a lot of help because it was a small magazine. So she had me doing everything from casting the models to, you know, going out in the market and walking around the East and West Village, picking out clothes.
Wow.
And she taught me also that it's not about yourself. And that was a big lesson, that you had to step outside of yourself and think about what something should look like. And it's not always going to be what you would wear or what you foresee as like something you'd have in your home or something. Like, it's really about digging into something and studying the culture of something to make it appear on the page.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. So I started working with her, and it, towards the end of the internship, we just formed this really unique bond, and she had such good taste. And her name was Jacqueline Bertelou, this cool French lady. And I remember saying to her at the end, I'm like, so this is like a real job, right? Like, people do this? Because it just didn't seem like work to me, you know? And towards the end of the internship, I actually went up to Kirby Rodriguez, I believe his last name was, a long time ago. And he was the art director of a fashion magazine called W Magazine at the time. And he oversaw, you know.
I used to love the photos in that magazine. I got it just for that. Yeah.
Yeah. I used to cut them out and make collages.
Totally.
So Kirby was like, wait a second. And he was sort of, you know, an upper tier dude. He had his hands in it, but didn't know like every bit of the day to day, I want to say. And I said, it was so great, you know, just getting to work on a project that you work on. And he said, wait a second. He's like, you don't work here? Like, he really thought I worked there. I showed up with such enthusiasm and extended my internship. And it was the beginning of everything, you know, I am today. Like, Jacqueline taught me so much. And it's so important to have someone who you can believe in, who can mentor you. And she was just super cool. And it was so, you know, in New York, days of Sex in the City. So that whole, you know, thing, she was the quintessential. I mean, she just always looked the part, but she was really low-key, down to earth, and, you know, wouldn't mind throwing out some bits of language that you were like, okay, you know.
Totally.
So, just a super cool chick. And I was really fortunate. And I feel so bad these days because, you know, the legalities of things, there have been so many interns who've like sued organizations because they work too long hours. And I get it. But the biggest learning experience I had was for an internship that I basically did for free and learned what I wanted to do and what I didn't want to do.
Right.
Yeah. And it was amazing. We worked with some of the best photographers and hair makeup people, like legendary people. So it was just I really stepped in it, you know?
Yeah. And so then was it through those connections that you sort of moved on to a professional paying gig, or how did that happen? How did your next step happen?
Yeah. So after school, I was really thinking, I studied journalism, and again, it was just like visual storytelling, and I've always been a real political person. And I kept, you know, when you're young and you're just trying to figure out where the hell you're going to go. And I kept jumping back and forth, between journalism, and doing some kind of creative or art direction. Like, these were very sort of small ideas of what these things were at the time, you know, their whole like meaning and the trajectory of where they could possibly lead you. I had no idea of. It just was a feeling. And I think a lot of my career has been based on a feeling. Like I've always gone with, at the moment, I ask myself the question about whether it's inspiring me. And that's why I think if you look at my resume, it sort of like jumps around in a lot of places, and it's what inspires me to be creative at the time. So I went into, I worked for Fox News Channel.
Wow. Yeah. People wouldn't get that about you, I don't think.
I know. Well, I felt, yeah. I mean, if you know me well, it's like almost shocking, but there's this saying that you know, you can't clean a house unless you're in it. And When I first started, that was a job that was available to me. And I knew that they were super conservative. I mean, look, hindsight's 20/20. Did I know all the things? No. You know, it was really a network that was just starting up. It was the beginning of cable news. And I worked with, you know, well, under Roger Ailes and Bill Shine and all these people who ended up being in, you know, political life in one way or another. Yeah. It served the purpose for me because it taught me a lot about how stories are formed and fair and balanced, but my version of it, because that was their slogan. But
yeah,
I was always booking the really liberal side of the argument. So, you know, if they were booking someone, I was like booking John Kerry or, you know.
And he would come on, those people would come on.
So I was, it got to the point, like before I left, I was actually coming up with segments that were being featured and I got to book incredible, incredible guests. And it was amazing. You basically scour the papers in the morning and decide what a real story is and what storyline you want to tell about that story that's different. And you write it, you know, you write the story and then you pick the best that you think could best sort of back it up. To me, that was incredible. But after doing it for a little over a year, I was watching the commentators and the newscasters and even the people at the top of their game. I saw them walking out and it was so funny. They'd sit down at the desk and look forward and really look unhappy. And I know they're exhausted because it's very hard work, but I'm saying like kind of miserable, right? And then the lights would come on and they would sit up and smile. And it was like, it was theater. So I just knew I didn't want to do it. If you look at the top of the game there and think about what they're doing, and part of it probably had to do with the fact that it was Fox. You know, I know this now as an adult, but I was like, I just didn't want to be them. So what's the point of going through, you know, my career in this area and not having something to look towards and look forward to? Yeah. So I called up my friend Jacqueline and I said, you know, hey, I am really going to start looking in the magazine realm because I want to get back into photography. And I just loved so much of what we were doing when I was interning. And it just so happened that there was a position at Details Magazine and the ABC had just bought, was it ABC at the time? Fairchild Publishing, who had Ms. Magazine. Do you remember Ms. Magazine?
Yes, of course.
So we got to like all work in this big newsroom, very fancy newsroom style office. With W and Ms. Magazine and Details Magazine. And it was like Fairchild was such a unique publishing house because it was just small enough to feel like a family, like every magazine knew each other. So,
wow.
And I felt like that publishing house was doing really, really good work. Like if you know what Ms. was up to, really sort of exploring, you know, the world in which women live and changing the dialogue and perspective, turning it upside down really at a time when that really wasn't popular or.
Yeah. It was kind of revolutionary almost.
Yeah.
You know, and crazy to think about.
Such a crazy, fun, unique bunch of New Yorkers and or transplants. You know, there was always something going on. It was this big sort of pot of creative people that just got to hang out and feel inspired by each other.